congratulations on having. And the event tonight is looking at sacred art. And with a particular detail on traditional Islamic art and architecture. The speakers we have are Adam Williamson, who was speaking first, and Lateefa Spiker. We will hopefully be working towards, well, aiming towards having a Q&A around 8 o'clock. So we look forward to any questions that you have. If you have any questions, please do keep them ready for them. Just to introduce them briefly, Adam Williamson comes from a family of craftsmen and artists, and is himself an award-winning sculptor and artist. He's undertaken a long list of prestigious commissions and exhibited internationally. Adam's given workshops and public lectures at many of the leading cultural institutions in the UK and beyond. He's travelled the globe to work with artists from diverse backgrounds and places, such as Mount Athos in Greece, Spain, Morocco and Turkey. Since 2010, Adam's regularly visited Jamaica, working as a consultant for an ongoing Prince's School of Traditional Arts project, which is supporting a group of wood carvers. In 2013, he also undertook consultancy work in China and Azerbaijan, which focus on preserving traditional craft skills in those areas. He's currently involved in an outreach program in Canada. I'll introduce Lateefa just before her talk. I'm just going to hand it over to Adam there so we can do the interesting bit.
Okay, thanks, Abbas. Okay, everyone. It's quite a visual. I'm going to be showing all the slides, so I was just wondering if you can all see at the back, and maybe you can turn the lights down a bit as well. If you can see, that's great. If you can hear me as well. Yeah, that's better. Okay. So, I thought it'd be nice to start with a quote from my teacher, Keith Critchlow. And this is a kind of, he'd follow this with meditation, we won't have to go that far, but it's always nice to start something with a good intention. So he would say, may beauty may we be guided by truth, may beauty be revealed to us, and may result in good. This is a bit of a calligraphy I did for him. Okay, so I thought I'd start out just by technology issues.
Maybe it's not on.
Thanks for your patience while we're getting this set up. Do you project? So, yes, okay. So I thought I'd start just by sharing some slides of my work, just to familiarise yourselves with what I do. Everything I do has really got a sort of craft approach and a hands-on approach. So this is a little bit of wood carving I've been working on. So I have this sort of standard, more like, this is my sort of, I guess it's quite a prestigious work, but it's more sort of formal approach. There's a piece for Prince Charles to stone carving. This is another one for Charles. This is the Queen Mother's Memorial. I've done some timelines for Kew Gardens. Can't really see them, it's a bit washed out in this slide. And then we do other projects, which are like public commissions. So this is a series of stones. These are huge limestones that we carved. This is my friend Will, who is working with me. And we took children's poems, both in English and Welsh. We smoothed these boulders and then carved children's poems into them. So also carved other materials other than wood and stone. This is a plaster piece. Sort of following in the tradition of the Moroccan carvers, stucco carvers. Also work with other materials. I work with a stained glass artist to produce this for Cambridge Muslim College. It's part of the college. It's in St. Paul's, and the sort of brief is quite difficult because it's an old vicarage. You have to be in kind of traditional European materials, but we wanted an Islamic pattern, so they're quite fun. I often find myself doing work like that with this crossover. So as I was saying, I have a big interest, which I'll talk about later, in Islamic art that really influences my work. So this is a piece, it's a photograph by one of our students, Leah, from the Alhambra. And then this is an interpretation in sculpture, so you can start to see this six-fold dancing shape. Really when you see it from the forefront, but it's really kind of influences all my work after 7 period. Okay, that's another example. sort of taking Islamic pattern and moving it into the three-dimension. Another example of that. So again, this is just sort of isolating elements to build an architectural structure. So it's quite nice. This has, it's just made up this pattern of just large circles. You can start to see them, but there's so much going on in there. You also have this syncratic yin yang shape in there as well. And I just like looking at tessellating shapes or using individual units and seeing how they can all fit together to create a structure. That's another example of that. And then that kind of concept really influences my sort of public work as well. So I like to sort of limit myself to just using, for example, one shape. In this case, I was just looking at just this one unit. The brief was just to work around these skylights that's on the roof of a school in South London. And the brief was really to not touch anything. So these are all freestanding benches, and they're all sort of compressed to the center. It's only when you tighten the last of like 300 bolts that the whole thing is secure and steady. I also did a lot of painting work. My first sort of line of work was a sign writer, so this person could stay. And this is a picture of Lateefa, it's a collaborative piece. We also have people like Sam, who's here tonight, worked on that. And this was, yeah, it's a really great sort of madcap project in East London. And we just painted all these walls using sort of Arabic calligraphy, but it didn't really say anything. So we put some little pieces in there, hidden gems. Didn't bother to read through it all. Okay, and I thought I'd just put in a couple of pieces of this. These are sort of stuff that I'm working on at the moment, some carvings I'm doing the last couple of few days, last few weeks rather. And this is again plaster work, but I'm looking at sort of metamorphosizing patterns. So you can start to see this pattern here is this series of squares and what happens when they sort of overlap. And this is all carved in plaster of Paris. And it's a fantastic material to use if you ever get a chance. It's somewhere between stone and wood. And you work it as it's drying, and then sort of as it's becomes more, as the moisture is released, it gets more resistance, and you can do the finer detail. And this is a commission for the NHS, and it's an asylum, a new asylum that's been built outside Preston. So I've got about 10 of these. I'll just put a couple up here. They're all looking at this theme of metamorphosizing geometric patterns, mostly six-fold patterns. And these are going to go all around the corridors. And I was quite worried because, should we say it, but I got, there was one of the service users sort of said, oh no, we're going to, the patients are going to start counting them and the OCD patients are going to go crazy. And I was thinking, oh my god, they're going to, what if they, surely they're just counting tiles if they're going to do that. There's this real issue and the whole project stopped, and even though I'd sort of sent designs initially, but all they'd seen was pictures, and it was really nice because I posted one yesterday, and this has actually been going on for months now. And as soon as they got it, they just phoned me up, and I was kind of full of trepidation yesterday, and then they caught up and said, everyone loves it, and all the people came in, all the service users were running their hands on it, saying, oh, it reminds me of Blackpool Beach, and so on. But it is really nice. I think just pictures often don't do justice to a piece, and a lot of what I do, I guess, is quite tactile. So another thing I do, as I was mentioning, was consultancy work, and I've kind of just fallen into it. It often feels a bit awkward, but I don't regret it for a moment. And this is a project I was working on in Jamaica for about 3 years, and these are my guys, and they're like, some of my best friends now. And I learned so much from them. This project was just looking at taking what they were doing already and just giving it an extra sort of 10% so that they could move into a different market. So just getting the finish right on their products. And now, they used to be selling these really lovely carved pieces for sort of $20, $30 to tourists, and now they're selling in America their pieces for hundreds of dollars. So it's nice, sort of success for them. And for me, it was great because before I worked with them, I'd really just look at, I'd get my wood from timber yards, and I had a different kind of approach to the material. But for them, they'd go in the bush and they'd find roots, and dig them out of the ground, and they would be able to look at a tree and see through the bark and all the splits and cracks. And I learned so much. And they had so little resources as well. Before I came, they just do everything with machetes and gouge chisels made out of old pipes. So yeah, it was really amazing to see what they can do with so little. So, yeah, we thought it was going to be an artist talk, and then we saw the title that was advertised on the website. We thought, say goodbye them on times, but I think it's a good challenge to think about and whether we represent that or not. So, I guess the big question is what is sacred and what is profane? I'd say to start with, just because something's religious doesn't mean that it's sacred. So I made that distinction right away. And to make it really basic, for me it's how it touches you. And if it touches something primal inside you and raises your consciousness. So the other question would be, are traditional and sacred synonymous? And this would be the case in the past. So you'd have guilds. This is a nice image I found where this bottoman craftsman. And these would be, you know, your teacher, the master craftsman, would kind of also be your spiritual teacher as well. And you'd have this, you know, drawn out period, a 7-year apprenticeship, where not only would you learn the craft, but you'd also have this spiritual journey. I just thought I'd throw this in there, because these apprenticeships would be set up in guilds, and this is a piece I did for the Paints and Stainless Guild, so they're still around, but they're kind of quite redundant now, just keep the buildings. So I have to say that tradition is often seen as something that's in the past, and it's this nostalgic approach to tradition, but it was never seen that way. It's something that should be just constant and constantly growing. And it's really just a sort of springboard, something that you can use to sort of create more with. So rather than just saying you're apart from what's come before you, you can just say that we're sort of continuing and adding and growing from that. And this is a nice quote from Bernard de Charge, and I think it's actually dwarfs standing on the shoulders of giants. It's this idea of just, we're just taking it that little bit further. And that's how I feel. I also thought I'd just say that, you know, not to be negative, but often there's this view that everything in the past is great, but often there is actually some quite sketchy work that's done in the past as well, so it's good to be discerning here. That's what we tell our students. I just put this in because often the masons, the early masons, when they're still learning their play, they've been working right at the top in the gallery. So if you ever go up high in cathedrals, that's where you'll see everything sort of wonky and So what happened is, we then had modernity and industry, and these guilds, you know, no longer viable. But I don't think that's the end of tradition in that sense. It's just a different way of working. So this is one of my favorite sculptors, Brancusi, and you can see here he's very heavily influenced by Romanian traditional art. So these are traditional Romanian pieces on the left here, the chest and this. And you can make lots of correlations, but things change. It's no longer, you know, studying under that apprenticeship. It's sort of, an appropriation or a kind of reinvention. Yeah. So this may be a more controversial one. This is the Chapman brothers, who made some pretty apprentice works. Until I met him, they came to my studio just by chance once, and they're actually quite lovely people, even though but this piece I actually liked. They did an exhibition like about 10 years ago. I just walked into the lab, and it was just working with African sculptures, and they all had something to do with my dance. So this is another way maybe people are back and rework old pieces. So as I was saying, for me it's all about the intention of the artist and maybe even the intention of the viewer too when they come to a piece. And from intention you get remembrance. And remembrance in sort of Sufi tradition is mentioned as zikr. And I like this Rumi idea where he says there was a man running, he was running through the woods and he was chased by hornets, and then he jumped in the river to escape the hornets. And every time he'd come up out of the water, the hornets would sting him, and the hornets were this idea of dunya, or the material world, his aspirations and all of those things. And the water was zikr, so eventually he just had to go under the water and just breathe in the water and sort of become one with it. And that's always really stuck with me, just sort of, like taking the plunge. So, to sort of keep that constant, that remembrance, you need a presence. And this really goes hand in hand with art and craft and that application. So this is a calligraphy process called Hitsu Zendu, where before you start, there's always this long period of meditation where you sort of focus and just really find out what this your intentions are and where you are, where you're placed. When you're working with craft, this presence is completely necessary, especially when you're working with wood. This is a carver, a picture I took in Morocco. And you have to really be, when you're working with wood, at one with the grain. And there's this concept of grain in Malaysia, especially where I did most of my sort of initial studying, of course, semangat. So this is a piece I carved when I was in Malay. And it's the sort of spirit I guess the Native American term would be the spirit that flows through everything. And it's seen most commonly, and most sort of profoundly rather, in wood and in the grain of wood. So this is actually a piece of communing wood, and this is taken from the roots of the tree, and so it's supposed to hold the most power. It's sort of a big deal when they gave this wood to work with. And I guess once you understand materials and the approach to materials, you start to understand maybe also the way the movement of nature and the way nature flows, and to be at one with that. And then amazing things can happen. Thank you. So this is, for me, it's like what happens when you're working, when you're kind of at one with material. And that's why I sort of haven't really expanded, because there's been lots of opportunity to take on loads of big jobs. And what ends up happening whenever I've kind of gone that bit further is I'm just sitting inside, ordering materials, and everyone else is having fun making. And so that's why I've always tried to keep small and just keep the tactile approach and the connection with my material. And that seems to be what's most important to me. So this is the idea of transmission now. And I just thought I'd talk a little bit very quickly. This is my father, so it all really started with my father for me. He was a craftsman and a woodworker. This is my teacher from Malay, Nor Haizan. I was going to show a film about him, but I don't think we have time, so send you a link. And I've been lucky enough to work with artists and people from all around the world, not just from the Muslim world, but also these are monks from Mount Athos, which I spent a time over there. Did some sketches of them. Couldn't really take any photographs. So
if you want to show the film, I think we can finish for them.
Okay, I'll see maybe at the end of this time.
Okay.
This idea of transmission, what I got from my teachers was really more than just the practical approach to cutting and slicing materials. Often it would just start with that process. Here's the tools, have a go. And I kind of worked those things out by myself after just hours studying a piece of stone. It was a lot more than that. It was maybe how to structure yourself, how to sort of apply yourself and just to kind of get stuck in, but not just in a physical way. And for me, what was really important was just being in my body. So I used to spend a lot of time, I was very interested in dance, sort of ecstatic dance, and also martial arts. This is a sensei, which Sam would know, he's a black belt, Kido. It's just me carving. Other things that it's very hard to explain this sort of this transmission, but in sort of practical ways, things I learned maybe from one of my teachers, my stone carving teacher here in Rees, was this idea of contrast and using the space around what you're working with. So this is a piece from Gujarat, India. For me, this really epitomizes all of these approaches. So you have this, everything grows from the seed from one place, everything flows continuously. And then you have this evenness, this like yin yang between foreground and background. And I thought this was a nice quote. I love Lao Tzu, and this is this kind of just exemplifies that use of the counter shapes, the space around. Often when we're doing drawing motifs with our students, we'll be just we sort of draw around the empty space first, and then wrap around the empty space to get the positioning. So I'll let you just read that one. maybe I'll read it quickly. Okay, 30 spokes meet in a hub, where the wheel isn't is where it's useful. Hollowed out clay makes a pot, where the pot's not is where it's useful. Cut out doors and windows make a room, where the room isn't, there's room for you. So the profit in what is in the use of what isn't. Okay, so other ways I learned were just through commissions. I was lucky enough to do commissions where I'd be in contact with great craftsmen. So this is a job I was really happy to do for the Globe Theatre. And it kind of tells, see my laser works, kind of tells the story of how the Globe was originally taken down, and then this is the passage of time, and then how it's rebuilt. And this chap here, his name's Peter McCurdy, and just spending time with him, you know, over a few months, trying to get his story to put into this cartoon. It used to be much more complicated before he narrowed the design down. You know, I learned so much about his sort of fearlessness. I mean, he was really taking on this huge project to rebuild the Globe, and all these craftsmen worked for him. And you know, I just learned so much just sitting with him, and you know, just keep him talking. He was an amazing craftsman. He'd say things like how they'd find the crux for the timber structures. They would go out into the forest and they'd have a cardboard cut up the shape they wanted, and they'd just walk around from a distance and just hold it up to trees until it found the right kind of, as the crux would sort of grow via like a branch that was going up the main trunk. So it's really incredible just their approach and how simple sometimes. I just put this is an image. We did some stonework in Westminster Abbey, but it just to remind me of one guy who used to work for me a lot, Will Whitmore, and he's, you know, he was working for me, but so much of the time, like, he was teaching me what to do. So yeah, like, you're learning things from everyone all the time. I guess my biggest teacher, who introduced the idea of geometry to me, was Keith Critchlow, and he teaches so many of my colleagues too. And I was lucky enough to hear him again on Wednesday, and it really reminded me of what I got from him. It was almost just his voice, as soon as I heard his voice. And I can't even remember what he was saying in the talk, but I came out just like, whoa, so inspired. And he's a really amazing man. He's 82 now, but if you ever get to see him talk anywhere, you should go for it. And he was the student of Buckminster Fuller. And I'd read a lot about Buckminster Fuller, but then one day I was driving, and I was listening to, you know, you just turn on the radio midway through a talk, and they were saying, oh, there's this man, he lost his daughter, his business had crashed, and everything was going wrong for him, and he was standing on the bridge, and he was just about to die, and he thought, you know what, why waste my life? Instead of jumping, I'm just going to put everything into trying to change the world and make an impact on the world and show, you know, the interconnectedness of the world. And then they said, and that was Buckminster Fuller, and I was like, yes. So yeah, his intention came from that point. And yeah, I was lucky enough to work a lot with Keith, and that's sort of, again, where I learned about the approach I have, I guess. And this is a piece in St. Ethelburg. So these are all stone carvings. St. Ethelburg is another really good place to go. It's opposite Liverpool Street Station, sort of multi-faced centre, but it was interesting things there. So he really introduced me to this interconnectedness of nature. This is a nice Fibonacci cactus. And how just, you know, he really connected up all the dots, you know, both in a spiritual, practical, and, you know, geometric way, and just how geometry is really the structure behind everything. I mean, he'd always start his talks with this Senge piece. This is sort of going, harping back to that Hitsu Zendo approach. Senge apparently went into meditation, and when he came out of the meditation, he just dipped his brush in into this one fluid movement. And this was sort of, for him, this was a representation of the universe. So yeah, you find geometry everywhere. And artists use it not just in a, you know, maybe sometimes on purpose, like Leonardo, but other times it would be just kind of interpretation or maybe accidental. Maybe I'll skip this one. So then, I mean, I was brought up by my parents that they're very interested in Sufism. So I already had quite an interest in that subject. And I'd been looking around, and I was always fascinated by these things. But was only when I worked with Keith that he really started to explain, sort of almost formulate and sort of, yeah, intellectualize what I was experiencing. And this is a garden, this is the Museum of Marrakesh. And I just thought I'd take you through just one pattern just so you understand how these things can be explained. This is a fountain, and the pattern here is called the Breath of Compassion. It's an Ibn Arabi thing that Keith has passed on. And it's just made up of square grid, but each of the squares, you can either expand them into a khatam, or you can reduce them into a cross. And when these are fitted together, you get this expansion and contraction, and this breath across the pattern. And this is, yeah, this would be the pattern simplified. And I was using these patterns without realizing it. These were some illuminations I was doing. This really, my sort of access to Islamic art was through the Mamluks and Mamluk illumination. That's what really got me fired up and interested. So again, you can see that this is just the one khatam and then the sides of the cross, the edges. This was my film, which doesn't work on this computer, so I'll skip. Yeah, so this is some another approach. Another view, this is Al Jabriya, who some say where it came from, and he's also known as Ibn Hayyan. And this is just using that pattern, the khatam, to identify the four elements, the four cardinal directions, four elements. And this is quite nice. I just took this from Keith's slides just from a couple of days ago. So he sort of started to bring in the idea of the Zemi and the Bionorphs. And the Bionorphs, for me, are the sort of development. I use geometry as the foundation, but in our teaching, and then using Bionorphs. So Bionorphs are just the sort of floral vegetative element of Islamic art. Also called arabesque, but arabesque just means Arab style. So it's this nice quote I found in Titus Burkhardt, which sort of exemplifies that. So in arabesque, all suggestion of an individual form is eliminated by the indefinity of a continuous weave. Thus, at the start, at the sight of the glittering waves, of leafage trembling in the breeze, the soul detaches itself from the internal objects, from the idols of passion, and plunges vibrant into itself, into a pure state of being. So, just before I end, I'm just going to show you a little bit about this, about Bionorphs and arabesque. So, it's one of my fascinations, and some of the students here will know. And arabesque and Bionorphs, often seemingly, I'll show you the slide. This is from the Atarin in Fez, from the Medina. They often seem completely void of any geometry. They just seem continuous and flowing over the surface. They're full of geometry. They all have these grids underneath them that help them repeat and tessellate across the surface. And I just thought I'd end talking about this transmission. Myself and my colleague Richard Henry, about 6 years ago, we had some students which were coming to the studio, and we were showing them some stuff and working together. We thought, oh, well, we should really set up some sort of structure, some course for them to work through, looking at Bionorphs and geometry and how to apply these things. And that's when we really ran a course called Islamic Pattern. And it's been really fulfilling for us. It's almost started to take over my life a bit without even planning for it. But it's so lovely. And we sort of do, so we have these courses in my studio, looking at Islamic Pattern, then we go around to Fez, to Granada, to Istanbul, taking students and studying these patterns with craftsmen, but in really just in the place where they were made, and getting it right for them. Yeah, this is a nice one. These are some kids from Abu Dhabi just a couple of weeks ago. And yeah, it's been fantastic for me because it's given me this opportunity to to really explore Bionorphs and to, I don't know, to further my research, just to sort of keep up with the demand of all these courses. But I'll just go back to this. Maybe this is a nice thing to almost end on, but I'm not really very good with social media, but Richard set up an open group, and it kind of epitomized the way this whole thing's going. And he only set it up a few weeks ago. It's already got about 500 or so people who are all adding images and text, and everyone's getting so excited. And for me, that's a real nice kind of cycle when I look at the journey I've been on. But I just thought I'd show you one quick thing. This is just how, this is a pattern we did in the Alhambra just a couple of months ago. And this is what we do. So we take students through just from first principles using a compass and a ruler. This is how we work through a pattern. These are the stages, and this is creating a weave here into the pattern. And this is completing the pattern. This is the pattern from the Alhambra. So we're working right next to the Alhambra on this pattern. And then this is the student's work. And then she's then taken that and carved it into leather. And then this is another example of a finished piece. But for me, even though it's kind of accidental the way I've ended up in this position as teacher for these students, I'm starting to see it now as a really nice cycle, and continuing Keith's work and the work of my teachers. So I'm really privileged to be in that position. And yeah, see the students completing that.
Thank you very much. Just as Lateefa is about to swap all the computers, I'll just introduce her. Lateefa Spiker lives and works in East London. Her reflective work explores the structures and flowing forms of traditional Islamic patterns and investigates the relationship between the transient and the infinite, spontaneity and order in the traditional and contemporary. Introducing movement into stasis, her work in meditates on the conflict of opposites and what lies beyond. Her work encompasses a range of mediums. Lateefa studied at the Prince's Foundation in the Building Arts in 2000 and went on to study the Greek course in fine art painting at Northumbria University. She subsequently lived and studied in Cairo and Andalusia, returning to London in 2006. She's since been working to commission, teaching and collaborating with other artists, including sculptor Adam Williamson. She recently returned from an arts project in British Columbia, working with the Ahusat First Nations tribe. Just to let you know, until we're ready, we're hopefully working so that we can start a Q&A session around 10 past 8. For around 30 minutes, leaving us about 20 minutes of informal networking to the end of it. Lateefa, whenever you're ready.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Well, firstly, I'd like to thank everyone who made it here in this cold mid-winter night, and also for City Circle, not only for inviting us to speak, but for letting us delve deeper into the subject. It is fascinating and huge. So yeah, when we got the title of this, I didn't really, well, I asked myself, what does sacred art really mean to me? And I didn't get any answers, I just got more questions. So some of my questions were, is the thing that makes something sacred to the observer the receptivity of that observer to the sacredness? Is it the intention and presence of the artist which infuses a piece of art with sacredness? Does all art have the potential of being or becoming sacred? Actually, isn't everything sacred? Then, I don't actually remember what my next slide is. Oh yeah, then I thought, if I was standing in front of a piece of artwork or listening to music, what questions could I ask? And these are some that I thought of. Does it invoke remembrance of an intelligence beyond our everyday material existence? Does it awaken our faculties of attention and presence? Does it help us transcend the limitations of the rational mind? Can it stimulate our hearts to open regardless of racial, religious, and social differences? Does it reflect back to us the deficiencies in our societies or ourselves? Does it have a sense of being beyond chronology, as its source is timelessness? Is it difficult to criticize, having only one worthy critic, the heart of the observer?
Yeah.
Well, this is a piece, a ceiling in Iran that I thought sort of encapsulated, kind of answered all those questions in the most simplest terms. So, I definitely couldn't say I was a specialist in any area except my own experience. So I'll start this with my first experiences, which is the community I was born into. And it's relevant because all of the people that became Muslim into this community, almost all of them were artists from the avant-garde scenes of the 60s and 70s. And all of them were obviously spiritual seekers as well. This is three of those band members became Muslim. This is Abdulhai Moore, surrounded by his theatre group called the Floating Lotus. I asked my dad about this because he was a sculptor. He's now a book designer and editor. But I just started up a conversation. It was really interesting because I was wondering if the creative process itself is something that opens you to a deeper search. So these are some of the things he told me. This is him in the 50s. So this is where he came from, a really conventional American family. And a lot of the people in that community came from very normal families, but they obviously had something in them, like that made them want to go into art. So that's what they already had, the searching kind of image. We were brought up in a pretty materialistic, consumer-orientated, uptight society that had just weathered two world wars and a severe depression. Art and or Eastern religions were the only obvious way out since the mystic form of Christianity had withered to accommodate the new materialism. And he also told me this. The importance of art for us then, in terms of the consumerism and spiritual aridity of modern Western culture, was to give a way of access to something within ourselves that rang true. So for many, I do believe art could be a useful stepping stone to contacting their true self and eventually reclaiming their spiritual heritage. So that's my dad, Artie, who did this. So they found in this community, it was actually a Sufi teacher from Meknes in Morocco. And what the first sacred art I probably was exposed to was his poetry, which they sang as in groups. It's very beautiful. This is him, Sheikh Mohammed ibn Habib. And this is some of his poetry, which was all compiled into a book. Look at every visible manifestation. It all gushes from the spring of energy and power. Consider all of them and then see the beauty of the truth. Take care, you cannot despise even the lowest atom. So I'm just going to take you through my own personal experiences while I was growing up. Until I was four, we lived in Granada in the old Moorish part of the city. And my mum would take us to the Alhambra all the time because it wasn't such a tourist trap then. And that's the Alhambra Barrack Palace from the Abbas Inn. So it just makes me think that even though I was so young, I think these kind of forms, however old your soul is, they affect you. And they... they remind you of an infinity that is beyond your material world, even if you're buried like a baby, I think. We also got taken to Morocco during that time a lot. And it's just everywhere. It's all talking about the infinite. It's all talking about unfolding infinitely. There's more Moroccan. Then I lived in Albuquerque, New Mexico, in a kind of experimental community. And the mosque was built by this amazing architect called Hassan Fati. That's the classroom. That's my classroom with all those domes. That's the school behind us. That's my class. That's me. That's me. And that's inside the school. This is Hassan Fati, and he built all of his architecture was made out of adobe mud brick. And he was he was kind of beyond his time, I suppose. He was also a violinist, which you can see in the proportions that he used in his application. And this is a quote I thought was really quite profound, which is about mud. Within the limits imposed by the resistance of mud, the architect finds a sudden freedom to shape space within the building, to enclose a volume of chaotic air, and to bring it down to order and meaning to the scale of the human being. And this is one of his amazing gouache paintings. This is the building of the school, so he actually brought Nubian masons over to teach the community where I was living how to build these vaults and domes in a traditional way. This is it when it's almost completed. That's one of its doors. And this is from above. This is it at the end. It's still used now. This is one of the corridors. This is what I remember doing, running up and down the corridor. So, as well as it being amazing to have an experience of going to school every day in that kind of, those kind of sacred proportions, and you know, he was really aware of all of the geometry. I think I first became aware of my connection to nature because the nature there is completely epic. Just this changing, you've got all these amazing rock formations, all these different colours that change with the seasons. It's a really amazing place. And Georgia O'Keeffe, she actually died a year before we moved there, but we lived, our house was just up the road from where her studio was. And these, you know, she just fell in love with the landscape. And that's her in New Mexico. And this is one of the quote from her that I thought was lovely. When you take a flower and really look at it, it's your world for the moment. I want to give that world to someone else. Another memory is just of the night sky there. The stars were just, there were so many stars you could hardly see the darkness in the sky. This is another quote from Muhammad ibn Habib. On the earth the signs for all who reflect, its wonders extend to the highest teaching. So nature really is the most sacred art. It's the closest, maybe, to the divine. And there are so many synchronicities and proportional systems that go through all of the all the way from the micro to the macro. And it's just incredible. And we are actually part of that sacred art. We are creation. This is all about fiveness. Another quote. Recognize the beauty of the essence in every manifestation. The spiral growth of the cactus in the Milky Way galaxy. All of my kind of fascination with nature, similar to Adam, I went to the Princess Foundation in the building arts. I did a building arts course because I was really into building. And there I met Keith Critchlow and Paul Marchant, who really introduced me to the geometry and nature, and it really opened my work up to and it's never left my work. And then I just wanted to mention about the art of design pattern. That's you. and just the power of making these patterns that the students tell us, and also we know because we do it ourselves, but it really gets you in touch with this, you know, people create the patterns and then they kind of recognize the patterns within themselves. And it kind of opens their minds and change their minds to a different, in a different way. Because we've got these kind of two parts of our nature, and one is, you know, divine law and, you know, structure and atomic whatever, then the other is just spontaneous and it's flowing and it's just, I don't know, when the two interact they just become this really beautiful combination. These are some of the study trips. That's in Fez, Istanbul. And just when people come together, they create this amazing energy. It's just always been like that every time. There's something that really unites people within making this kind of art. This is a quote from one of the students. It's so important that this form of art and the knowledge behind it is available to the public to learn about the experience and experience. Modern man needs more than ever before a form of beauty that is a crystallization of primordial truths, giving access to those truths and therefore creating a form of balance and peace in their minds and hearts. Islamic art is certainly one of those forms of beauty, and thus the knowledge and experience you're offering is of the utmost relevance and value. So that's very beautiful. Now I think I really wanted to mention the... Actually, I want you to join in on this. Because it's something that me and Adam have been doing, going out to this First Nations community in British Columbia on this little island called Flores Island. And it's... So that's Vancouver. Can't really see it. This is America, that's Canada, that's Vancouver Island. So that's the edge of Vancouver Island. Flores Island is right on the far western side. And this is Flores Island. It's completely just virgin, incredible ancient forest. And this, the community live here. And it's a small First Nations reservation. This is the kind of landscape that surrounds it. And most of it is just doesn't have any human habitation. That's me and my son's aid in the forest. And that's the school we were working at on the island, that's Zayd and Adam. But the reason why I wanted to mention it is because the traditional art forms of their culture, obviously their culture's been crushed and almost destroyed by colonialism and the residential school system, and honestly I've never heard such horrible stories. And also the effect it's had on the communities there. Someone told me that about 10 years ago, about 90% of the population of this island were either drug addicts or alcoholics. And they turned it around, and there's a huge suicide rates and things like that. They turned it around themselves, and we met this amazing lady called Rosalie, and she was a carver since she was 10, but she also went through, her stories were just terrible, you know, everything you can imagine. And it was her art actually that kept her going. And the way that they turned around their island is that they took people to another island as a kind of, what do you call it then? No, rehab. They kind of created their own rehab. And they used traditional craft. It was like an integral part, and it really, really helped them, and people felt like they were coming home to their traditions. And now, I mean, 90% of the population are clean, and you know, there's just so much hope, and the traditional art is something that engages the youth as well, and it just gives them an identity. It's just really powerful. Without it, I think they'd be much more lost. This is just, that's some of our students and the way they sing their traditional songs and things like that. And then, I suppose I'll show you a bit of my work quickly. This is a ceiling installation. This is called Primordial Patchwork. And it's kind of like looking at your life as a series of moments and being able to reflect back and all making sense as a whole. This is actually about how, it's called The Breath of the Compassionate, because it's about how everything quite often gets stripped away. When everything does get stripped away, you're always left with your core, and sometimes you realise really important things when everything's taken away from you. That's mechacentric, so that represents the carver in the middle, which also represents your heart, and people going around it and facing towards it. This is called Urban Prayer. And it's really all about, these are the prayer positions here. that's the part that is the buildings in London or any big city. But it's really about turning away from materiality to the divine. Oops, sorry. And this is about being still, meditating, and it all grows from the heart. And also our connection to nature and how we are part of nature. And this is just looking at opposites and how they interact with each other. And this is talking about the whirling dervish, whose axis is his heart, is his or her heart. and the divine inspiration comes into the right hand, and from the divine comes down into the earth. But it's also about kind of fana, which kind of just losing yourself in the oneness of everything. I think that's it. That's all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you most deeply both to Adam and Lateefa. That was quite an inspiration for me. I'm sure it was for everybody here. I work in completely different media. I work as a poet and a playwright, so my work is text-based. And to see visual art so readily encompass and work with the ideas of sanctity.
We developed this whole area of Baku, the old area, but rather than getting the carvers to complete the designs, it's all CNC machine. And I don't know, like, everything feels a bit soulless and a bit flat. Whereas, like, even if they'd used the CNC machine, but then retailored and redressed all the stone afterwards, you know, the whole thing would have a completely different feel. So for me, it's the kind of hands-on approach which takes it to another level and gives it that soul and spirit, breathes some life into it.
Can you tell the difference between something that's finished by machine and by...
Yeah. Yes. Well, you can feel it, and then if you really know your stuff, you can go and just see the circle, little circular marks, or you can see the chisel marks. Or
you don't even need to know
it's too regular.
Yeah, it's
like
I was quite... sorry to interject, but... That question reminded me of my last visit to Medina and the old part of the mosque compared to the new machine cut marble pattern work, and how it was just strikingly kind of, it just really had a different feel. And it wasn't, just wasn't right.
I just found a book, I think it was published in 2010, but really interesting. I only just got it, so I can't, but I'll give you the title of it, but it's all about modern media is actually, its origins are actually in Baghdad. It's really crazy. I'll give you the title. But it's like the link to kind of algorithms and all of those kind of things. You think of from here. And it goes really deep into the history of Islamic aesthetics and things like that. It's really amazing.
So
yes.
What is that title?
Yeah, I'll have to get it and then I'll...
Thank you both very much for this presentation. There's just so much there that I could ask about, but I guess I'll stick to one thing, which relates to my own work as a doctor. There's more than once the idea of kind of working with natural materials and the tactile element, but also the creative aspect of working with communities that have been affected by changes and how that's affected them psychologically and also kind of does their health. I was wondering how you think we could and should incorporate the arts more into healthcare in the NHS in the UK. And, I'm a GP, so I can appreciate. I'm quite interested in the interaction between the humanities, the arts, and sciences. And,
yeah.
And I try and bridge some of those kind of gaps that you see. That,
that can help in different ways. But I was wondering what you guys...
Well, I had a recent experience with this project I was working with up in Preston, and I had to go into a series of asylums and work with the patients there. And it was difficult, like some of them, I turned up and I couldn't take any of my equipment because it was all, you know, it was quite high security. So I had to ad-lib the workshops. But it was amazing because all the service users, that's what they call the patients, they all had different conditions. Some were so drugged up they were falling off their chairs, but like as soon as we started working, especially with pattern and with their hands, like everyone was completely absorbed. And the staff were telling me afterwards, you know, for example, one kid, he had a psychotic episode, and he's got mania. And they said, you know, just this half an hour of concentration, the rest of the day will be completely calm and focused. So, and that's what I had feedback from. So I guess it has. I know the effect it has on myself, but this is the experience I've had.
Also, there's a traditional hospital, the traditional Islamic hospital, you know about them as well, where they would have a live band, you know, always playing and creating music. They'd use smell and garden, beautiful gardens, and that would all be part of the normal hospital. And I mean, to bring some of that into, and also, you know, maybe to have hands-on geometry, I mean, I'm sure it would be very new. And actually, I did think that one of the most important aspects of sacred art is that it heals, I think. Maybe that's one of the most important.
Any other questions? And please feel free to also just engage in the work, you know, feedback, thought about it, as such. I'm sure the artists would like to hear about that. Well, 14 upon them anyway. any feedback or anything? Yes, sir.
One of the things that came across to me with both presentations with regards to the definition of sacred art was a spirituality which is relatively neutral of any kind of form of doctrine or dogma. But my question is whether, what is your take on that? How does that fit within a definition of sacred art? Because to quote, like for example, the slide that you put up of there's an atomic structure of things that's very defined, and then there's a freedom of movement, and when you combine the two of them, they work very well. I'm not sure that I can see how, if you take bits of each thing, like even with the perennialist philosophy, there's a commonality that's underlying, but there's a structure that exists throughout the whole of it, because each wave comes along, it's a distinct wave. You know, if you take antlers off a stag and put it on a toad, it's no longer majestic kind of a thing. So the question is whether, is the dogmatic structure of various different traditions essential to defining what sacred religion is, sacred art is?
I think the structures of all religions are really, really valid, and I think within those structures, sacred art can be birthed. I think it's, you know, they contain something so powerful, and it can come out that way. And maybe that's the only way, I don't know, but then when you question, you know, what is really sacred, you know, is all art sacred? Because all art is a reflection of, I mean, you know, it's just big questions.
The point is it can be, right? And if anything can be sacred. But
well,
it's
the question I ask, you know.
Is.
I mean, it's so broad. I mean, I don't think you can contain it. It's uncontainable.
The reason I ask the question is because you can apply the same logic to anything. So a profane artist would say the same thing, that this is a piece of art, and it's important because it elevates something within someone. Whether it's actually that has a real value or not is a function of the observer and his faculties to see.
But I guess as well as the art. I mean, that's what we're saying, that it is really up to the observer and up to the intention that you put into the work. Because if you, you know, I read a lot of philosophers, and for me, like, it's kind of refreshing because they're sort of quite direct, but I feel like they throw the baby out the bathwater and sort of, you know, they have all these crazy cut-offs like, oh, then nothing after the Renaissance or Baroque period is worthy of, you know, looking into you. And they, you know, they're trying to order things, but I feel like it's all about the soul, right? What you're doing, you know, space you're in when you're making the work.
But it's also about limits as well. That's why, you know, it's just a really big subject that is kind of unanswerable.
The question you put in the beginning was quite clearly that's what's going to answer it. You put a few questions, does this art make you feel? And this is exactly the answer it should be. Look at this question, if it satisfies you, that's the answer.
Yeah, but those questions were just questions that I was asking. I don't know if there aren't.
But this is what is moving in any art. You should find the answer to all these questions.
The question of dogma is interesting. Well, I'll come to your question next time. Just to expand on that a little, for me it feels like it's a question of perspective. Either everything is sacred or nothing is. And the viewpoint you take is your choice, I suppose. Looking at it from a story structure, which is what I'm more comfortable with, sacred stories, which is the medium of choice in most religious dogma. So, in the Hindu text, in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, and the Quran, divinity employs stories by which to impart messages. And then the prophets themselves occupy, a narrative. All those stories actually have the same structure. And that's not dependent on which religion that is. The story that happened in the Mahabharata, that Krishna, for example, goes through, isn't too removed from Jesus's structure, not the details, but the structure within the story. So I feel that either means that everything is sacred, or that nothing is. And that's my perspective on it. I think perhaps that might be a contribution to that question. Is there anything else you want to pick up on that before we move on?
Well, just with regards to that, I take the point, and I think it's a similar thing to the slide that you put up, that there is, my understanding, and I'm completely not creative at all, I'm a mathematician, so I'm speaking totally out of turn, but it's my understanding was that there is a commonality of godliness, so to speak, that is everywhere.
Including in maths.
quite specifically in maths. But outside of that, for it to exist in this world, there is crystallizations of it. Of the form, and so that those forms are essential. I think philosophically, I think that you can't get away from that. And so I think that from my perspective as a layman on sacred art, whether it's written or whether it's visual, I can't understand how you can dispense with that form, the doctrine. Islamic art within the confines of Islamic art, there will be commonalities, there will be, the water's the same, but the waves are different.
But the forms you're talking about, I guess, is what we're, is the geometry, it's the proportioning of things and the way things are laid out. And a lot of Islamic art has just moved out of other cultures. When you look back at early Islamic art, it's sort of growing, it's using Byzantine art, it's using things that came before it. So,
Fair enough.
Yeah, there are a lot of crossovers.
Sure.
But what I'd say is that the commonality is the geometry, because it's very easy to see the connections when you look at how.
Also, it's created for human. It's created for any human. It's not only created for Muslims.
No,
That means it doesn't really have value in some ways, but it does conform to the rules of the universe. There are limits. You can see in the geometry of nature. So maybe the limits are just beyond religion. The universal and primordial laws of the universe.
The gentleman, is that okay?
Yes,
sure. Yeah, thank you. The gentleman in the random lecture.
Hi there. I just want to say thank you for presenting what you've shown there. It's really interesting. And what I can say is that you've kind of embraced the Islamic geometry pattern or Islamic geometry or Islamic art. Now, what I'd ask you is there like a another revisiting or kind of like an Islamic Renaissance happening or coming, but also maybe listening to the conversations, maybe it's more to do with a spiritual Renaissance or revisiting spirituality in that way, where it's just universal or the constant forms which are universal in many cultures or faiths or religion. Do you see that is happening now? Do you see it's coming, or is there something that's kind of blooming in that way? Because you travel as well, so you might be able to see that in other parts of the world as well.
Well, yeah, I mean, we're definitely seeing it. I don't know whether it's only because we have access to a lot more through social media or just through the connection with the students. But when we were studying, you know, 10, 15 years ago, you know, there was only like 5 people a year and really distinct, you know, people coming from all around the world, but it was very specialist. And now it seems like, yeah, everyone's interested in, there's so many different ways to access it. And yeah, there's lots of alumni from Kiev who are out there teaching, and there's sort of, and it's not just, there's obviously a hunger for it, otherwise there wouldn't be this, there's a demand. So whether that's an interest in, you know, people's cultural past, or, you know, an aspect of their religion, or whether that's a sort of spiritual yearning, I don't know. There's definitely a huge interest now that wasn't there just 5 or 10 years ago.
Well, I mean, I remember kind of Google searching geodesic domes or sacred geometry about 10 years ago, and not very much came up. Now, if you do it, it's just...
Any other questions? Feedback? Comments? Yes, you
I want to ask about how you're defining Islamic art. The Islamic world is a huge, huge area.
Yeah.
Massive amount of different cultures.
Mm.
In the art that you've studied, when you go to Malaysia and compared to the UK or even Arabia, how different is the output of that art? I mean, is it something you can look at it, you know, this is from that area,
yeah,
or this is Islamic?
Yeah,
in
so you can, there are lots of regional differences. But usually they all follow the same fundamental principles. So for example, if you're looking at arabesque patterns, you have certain key things that you have to follow, and they're all interpret those different ways. Usually the differences are simple, like the motifs, so they'll reflect the local environment, or there'll be a slight effect from something that was there previously. So for example, in Malaysia, you know, a Hindu element or like a Buddhist element that kind of features in that. And it can become controversial, like in Malaysia it's really controversial. We thought when we went there, we were making a documentary on modernity wiping out traditional arts, but what we found it was actually just fundamentals. It's a big subject, but you know, because they had these syncretic elements, because there was a little bit of all the religions in there, they were just like throwing big, yeah, they're just trying to get rid of everything. But so yeah, you can see it's definitely this Islamic. You can see that it's Islamic art, but then it's very easy after a while to see the regional differences. And you can also see the movements after a while as well, how these things develop. So a lot came from Central Asia and China, especially with the violence, and then slowly were developed and moved.
So I think a feature of Islamic art isn't even looking visually similar, but it's actually raising up the profane art of the area where the Muslims settled, making it remind people of God. So you can see that, and that was kind of what Islamic art did. It didn't actually push its form onto where it went. It transformed it, so it was more transcendent.
Can I ask another question? Actually, talking about the Islamification of like new areas where Muslims would have gone to, there's a movement, isn't there, that art that's coming out of the contemporary traditional Arab world and Muslim world is starting to emulate, in terms of style, a lot of Western forms of art.
Yeah.
Could you comment a little bit about that and what's happening to the traditional forms,
yeah,
which were there, which were immensely beautiful? And just as a second aside, is that in terms of the kind of philosophy of Islamic art, there's the rituals, Islamic patterns, there's all of that type of stuff that's available.
Yeah.
From the Islamic world, are there teachers that you've come across? Is there
yeah,
work that you've come across?
Well,
which is not just teaching you the form, but actually teaching the philosophy. But
yeah, well, it's been so long now that we kind of forget that we're white guys going like teaching in the Middle East, and how strange that I must seem to people there. It kind of, yeah, I was part of that movement in a way. I set up this organization called Crosso Foundation, which turned into the Secret Edge of Arabia, which you might have heard of, and that's like really growing Saudi art, but it's all sort of went in the direction of But as far as like the Islamic world, we travel and we've all travelled searching for these craftsmen, you know. So they might be out there, but we've certainly haven't found them and we've been looking.
For example, Richard,
but
the ones who actually design the, you know, original patterns, there, a lot of them using templates.
So Richard went to Iran on this mission and to find craftsmen, and everywhere he went, so, you know, everyone was more interested in these notebooks, and he ended up doing, you know, ad-lib classes, and so it's that experience that has sort of given us confidence to go and teach in this space. Otherwise, we would have felt a bit funny about it. I mean, in Morocco, I had someone say, tell their kids, you better go to school, otherwise you'll end up a craftsman, and that's the sort of the attitude and the approach to crafts. So, you know, there are people out there, and, you know, you see little glimpses, like, you know, Morocco seems to be the place, the last kind of real plastic of crafts, and then there are some craftsmen who draw and, you know, give you an idea of, you know, sketch things out. A lot of it's sort of fourfold and quite basic, and using slide rules and a very different approach to keep, you know, using the compass and generating patterns that way. And you can really see examples, the more you look at that was the way it's done. I mean, just in Marrakesh, for example, we saw in Madrasa there, like the plaster work. It's very rare, but we saw all the compass work. So we were absolutely, you know, very faintly, but you could see the dividers and how they're scratched into the plaster to create the subgrid. Because that's another controversy, whether it was just the compass that generated these things, or whether it's, you know, practical angles.
There's a question behind you, sir.
Yeah, sorry. There's been a lot of talk about, I guess, how the concept of Islamic art itself is quite a nebulous sort of thing to define. But from a sort of my view as a layperson, there's always been sort of geometric aspect and also sort of the calligraphic tradition, which I guess, again, sort of goes towards the visual and textual aspect put together. Do you think there's been a change in dominance in sort of in the Islamic art world of one or the other, or and for yourselves, how do you sort of incorporate that other sort of tradition in what you do? Or?
Yeah, so there's a hierarchy in Islamic art, and it, the geometry is the foundation, and then above that you have the arabesque or the bimorphs. This goes back to your question. We don't use the term arabesque because it just means Arab style, but it's something that's obviously practiced right across the Islamic world, so that's why we call it bimorphs. And then at the top of the hierarchy is the calligraphy, because it's the word of God. And they all feed into each other in this practical sense as well. So the as I showed briefly in the slides, the geometry is the foundation for the bimorphs, and then especially for the cursive scripts, the calligraphy really draws on these the bimorphic principles of, you know, growing from one seed and continuous movement.
I guess it's, one of the questions was, has there been a change in the dominance of what's prevalent in
I guess you see when you go to the Gulf is a good example, because there's lots of buildings and things going up there, but it's, and you would take the patterns and be like, oh, that's a rosette that represents Islamic art, it's passed that across the wall and it's Islamic art. But I don't know whether one is pushing more than any other or what's going on, but certainly the understanding has changed, and it's a real shame in the Gulf that there is this Western looking way. Even when they create Islamic art, they kind of get Western architects who have no idea about Islamic art to develop them. So the mosque in Abu Dhabi for me is quite controversial, because things seem completely out of proportion there. And you can tell what's happening, because I've been in some of the meetings with architects where they've, you know, got these spreadsheets and they've been like, well, you know, I have a bit of that, a bit of this, and it's all put together, and it's the actual application is fantastic. They've got Moroccan craftsmen in there, but, you know, whereas like you'd have friezes which are this sort of size and things in proportion, they're just like big and massive, and it's so it's a weird it's nice from a distance.
I want to take my prerogative as chair and ask a question as well. There was an artist called Ibrahim Osama, who was a Sudanese artist. I think, did you catch his exhibition? It was at the Tate last year or something, last summer. And when I bought his book, it was interesting how he was so aware of the spiritual process that accompanied his creative process. And he's a visual artist, he's a painter, a sculptor. He wouldn't create his work without being in a state of ablution. He'd always make wuzu before before creating his work, and that was his kind of, that was a level, I suppose, of his awareness of mutual dependency. Your creative process, does it have, are you aware of, to what extent, I suppose, are you, or do you recognise the spiritual parallel
in the sort of preparation for...
Yeah, just in your general creative process.
Yeah, well, I guess just going back to the example I was trying to use in my slides, something like wood carving, more so than stone or any other materials, it really epitomises that, where, like, for a second, if your mind wanders, then you'll hit the grain wrong and everything kind of...
Yeah.
And it's really just understanding the way the thing's moving and being constantly present in a state that... that you can work with the material, but I mean that's the physical application, but I feel that's a good example of what's going on also in your soul. And often you have to, you know, these things, you have to see the anti-matrix, you have to see something within the material, so you're kind of visualising that when you're working as well, it's like seeing beyond what you're doing, so there's a lot going on. You can't do that unconsciously.
Of course.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
And for you, sir?
So yeah, definitely. I think also to the person who's viewing your art, you can really tell if the artist was really present while they were doing it. And, I mean, I actually listen to books quite a lot while I'm painting because I find that that occupies my mind and then I'm just free to work without my mind anymore. And yeah, and that obviously what I really like about doing my work is that I have to keep in a certain state in my life. It makes me more disciplined in that way, because if I'm not, then I can't be receptive to, you know, because obviously you don't think it comes from you. You have to kind of be empty.
Yeah, of course.
So it encourages you to keep that up. So that's fantastic.
Yeah, it's like this idea that we were talking about the other day about how you know, if you live with your hand open and then people will put things in your hand and take them up, but as soon as you close your hand, you know, nothing comes up.
We could call it a day here and leave some time for informal networking where you're free to come and speak to the artists as well, and chat amongst yourselves. Any pressing questions, or should we say thanks? Well, thank you very much. Oh, pressing question over there.
Yeah, it's not a pressing question.
It's okay, we'll have it anyway.
I've been trying to formulate a way of asking or sort of saying what I wanted to say. Well, I guess it is a question, not a pressing question. About what are your thoughts about art, which is something visual and expressive, and language?
Say that again.
The relationship between art and language, and I think my thoughts come from, I'm a therapist, and the question from the GP about meaning and how it can be helpful.
Mm.
And I'm aware that art therapy is very helpful, and it's sort of research therapy. And art therapy works because people can't express themselves through language very well, or what's going on through language.
Yeah.
And I just wondered if you have thoughts about that.
Well, it's certainly a language within itself. I mean, for things that are inexpressible through words, I mean, it's a way of transmitting a feeling between two people. And also, I found really interesting when we were in Burroughs Island working with the house settlers, how it was their language, which is almost completely gone. I mean, the elders, they're dying out with their language. The young people aren't keen enough to learn it. But their art forms really, when you look into their language, you can tell that it's all part of the same, like the nature has kind of formed their language, and then their language, and they don't write anything down either, it's all in, all of their stories are in their pictorial. I don't know, it's just, that's the first time I really thought, wow, language is so powerful. And also taking away someone's language, like the colonial forces did in Canada and America. They knew how powerful the language was, because that language was it was like a freedom of thought that came with it, like a much more expansive way of thinking, and they narrowed that down to the English language. That's really, I mean, it's not really related to what you're saying.
No, I think it is. I guess my thoughts were around how much can get lost, not with the idea of language, but when you try and verbalise something that's expressed
yes,
a lot.
Yes, definitely.
And that's what I was quite curious about in regards to your own experiences of that, because, you know, you're trying to verbalise something which is actually expressed very differently, and in a way expressed through embodiment or something as well.
Yeah.